Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Path in the Darkness by M.D. Cooper, narrated by Khristine Hvam. Mars, stellar date 3/22/72/79, November 22nd, 41/23, adjusted Gregorian. Location, Mars 1 ring, M1R. Region, Mars Protectorate, Sol Space Federation. 40 years earlier, while the Intrepid was still under construction above Mars. Tanis walked into the elevator's main cabin, peering through the throngs of people for a seat near a window. She spotted one on the side that would have an eastern view and slipped through the crowd, managing to secure it before anyone else. The captain's message instructed her to come wearing civilian clothing. She managed to find one complete outfit that didn't look military. A pair of tight, dark blue jeans, a white blouse, and a burgundy jacket. She pulled at the jacket as she sat, ensuring that the sidearm strapped to her side was out of sight. The captain hadn't said anything about weapons. Conversation buzzed around her as 1,000 people all found seats and stowed whatever they were carrying. The sounds of vendors preparing food came from the balcony above the cabin. Tanis took in the 1,000 sights, sounds, and smells, her senses on alert for any sign of danger. "Do you think you were followed?" Angela asked, conspiratorially. "Who knows? You know I can't just turn it off." Outside the elevator, on the surface of Mars 1, the final few passengers were walking over the manicured lawns leading up to the entrance. To her left, Tanis saw a pair of cargo haulers drive away over the low hills surrounding the elevator, their beds empty. The clock on the local net showed departure time in 9 minutes. Tanis settled back, anticipating the view. She believed that no planet was more beautiful to drop onto than Mars. Perhaps it was because she had grown up there. A young girl sat to Tanis's left, peering out the window with excitement. "I can't wait to get there," she said as she bounced in her seat.
"Easy now, dear," her father said from beside her. "We'll be dropping soon enough."
"I can't wait to see Mommy,"
the girl smiled.
"I know."
The father patted his daughter's head.
"It's only been a few days, but it feels like so long."
Tanis smiled at the girl, wondering what her life would have been like if kids had come into the picture. She hadn't been much older when she first rode the elevator back down to Pavonis Mons. She spent the rest of the time before the drop reviewing leads and lines of inquiry around the attacks on the Intrepid. She wasn't certain what the captain thought was more important, but he wasn't a man given to frivolities, so it likely was worth her time. An alert came over the local net and audible systems, giving the 15-second warning for the elevator's departure. Tanis cleared the work from her mind and prepared for the moment. A gentle shudder rippled through the deck and the elevator began to rise above the surface of Mars 1. Tanis always found it somewhat incongruous that, due to centripetal force, space elevators had to climb toward the planet. Over the course of the trip, gravity from it would decrease and the passengers would enter a period of zero G. At that point, the cabin would rotate and the passengers would reorient with their feet facing down to the planet. Even after decades of traveling between space and planets, Tanis still found it took as long as an hour to shift her thinking about what was up and down. Both rings and free-orbiting habitats always oriented so that their parent planet or moon was up. Almost all time in space was spent with a world hanging overhead. On the surface of a world, space was what was hanging above. Tanis always had a period of feeling like she would fly off the surface of the planet into space. With 17,000 kilometers to travel, the trip would take over an hour. Tanis leaned back in her seat and gazed up through the angled windows as her home world grew larger above her. The most distinctive feature of Mars was the Borealis Ocean, which covered the northern third of the planet. The southern two-thirds consisted of a massive supercontinent, broken up by small crater lakes and the larger Hellenic Sea. Tanis recalled vacations she had taken with her family on the sea when she was younger. She found it odd that her father always insisted on leaving the shores of the Mariner Valley to go to another sea halfway around the world. After a few more minutes, the Mariner Valley became visible, and Tanis strained to make out the Melis Chasma, where she had grown up. She remembered the long, idyllic days of her youth, swimming in its deep blue waters and spending time fishing and boating on the valley lakes. Once, when humans first settled Mars, the Mariner Valleys were ideal sites for habitation. The mile-deep cracks in the Marsian surface offered protection from the sandstorms and provided a safe haven for nurturing a heavier atmosphere. Today, those initial habitations were curiosities that tourists could view in submarine tours. To her left, she could see Olympus Mons, the Sol system's largest mountain, a massive volcano which rose over 22 kilometers above the seas, which lapped at its western shore. Tanis had climbed the cliffs at Olympus's edge several times on training missions. At over 9 kilometers high, they were brutal, even in Mars's low gravity. Once on the mountain, it was almost impossible to tell it was a mountain at all. With a base nearly the size of the province of France on Earth, it seemed more like a gently sloping hill. Tanis enjoyed watching the clouds drift across the surface above her, until the local net sounded the warning that full zero-G was near and the cabin would flip. Several minutes later, the passengers found themselves staring up at the glistening latticework of Mars One and the MCEE, with all their elevators, shafts, and anchors reaching out into space. It was quite the change from staring at the idyllic garden world. Less than 10 minutes later, the elevator dropped into a shaft cut deep into Pavonis Mons. The Shield Volcano was amongst the smallest of the massive volcanoes on Mars, but at over 8 kilometers above sea level, it was still huge by any measure. With its peak and most of its 100,000 kilometers of slopes eternally sheathed in ice, the debarkation area for the elevator was deep underground, with maglev train service out to the nearby city of Sheffield on the high, arid Tharsis Steppe. Tanis transferred to the train within minutes of the elevator settling within its cradle on the surface. The trip to Sheffield would take a couple minutes, and from there Tanis would transfer to a low-orbit jump jet to the location the captain had provided, on the island of Elysium. It had been over a decade since she last set foot on Mars. She still remembered that fateful day when her family had sided with her ex-husband and all but ostracized her. In retrospect, with a more measured eye cast toward her former spouse, she wasn't surprised he had cut ties with her. But she never expected her father to cut her off as well. The urge to check in on him was strong, but she closed that train of thought off. That part of her life was over. Soon she would leave Sol, and they would be a part of her past, nothing more. "I'm sorry," Angela said. "I know we agreed not to talk about this, but you were thinking it so loud. I'm just sorry." Tanis sighed. "It's okay. I should try not to think of it while I'm here." Seeing home, even if it was from thousands of miles away, brought back a lot of memories. "There are good memories there. Don't forget them." Tanis nodded and turned her mind to work, sifting through reports to take her mind off thoughts of family. 30 minutes later, the jump jet touched down in the city of Aalborg. Tanis hailed a ground car and gave it the name of the restaurant the captain had provided. When she arrived, Tanis saw that it was a small, street-side cafe with flowers overflowing its planters and the smells of good cooking coming from inside. She entered and spotted the captain sitting at a table beside a window. He was wearing a plaid shirt, and the image made her think of an old woodsman. "Good morning, Jason," she said as she slipped into the booth. The captain smiled and ran a hand through his hair. "A good morning indeed, Tanis. I'm glad you can make it on such short notice."
"Coffee, dear?"
A slim woman wearing an apron with the cafe's logo on it asked Tanis. "Yes, cream and sugar, please." The woman poured a glass, and as Tanis reached out to take it, the captain put his hand on hers.
"Was the trip pleasant?" he asked.
Tanis had a moment to wonder if this was some elaborate ruse to get her alone and make a pass at her before she detected the nano he had slipped into her hand. It contained a coded message, and Tanis decrypted it as she replied, "It was nice enough. I took the scenic route down the Pavonis elevator. It was nice to see the valleys one last time." The captain nodded as he sipped his coffee.
"I remembered that you grew up there. I've sailed those seas a few times. Amazing views."
Tanis read the message as the captain spoke about his adventures on Mars' high seas. "Enfield has a highly sensitive secret package he needs brought aboard the Intrepid. It contains materials which will be needed for manufacturing on New Eden. We are to meet with a contact in a park near here. He will take us to the package." Tanis and the captain discussed pleasantries until the time drew near for them to meet their contact. As they talked, she wondered what the special cargo could be. There were dozens of things of incredible value already on the Intrepid, and they had been successfully delivered by conventional means. She wondered if Terence thought so little of her security on the ship. Then again, he had sent her to pick it up. The captain passed his token over the local net to the cafe, and they walked out into the street toward the park. The walk was pleasant and only took a few minutes. They kept up light banter about the weather and the things they saw around them, careful not to speak of anything more significant. In the park, they walked to a low wall overlooking a pond and leaned against it, admiring the view.
"Good morning,"
a man said with a smile as he walked past. Tanis nodded in return, and suddenly knew why she had been called in. The captain could never have picked up the message she had just been delivered.
"It's coordinates and data for coded entry."
Angela's assessment matched Tanis's. "Not often you get a message delivered by breath," Tanis replied. She reached out and touched the captain's arm, sending him a coded message via the direct contact.
"We're to proceed to an office tower a few blocks from here. There's a maintenance door we're to use around the back. From there, I have to pass tokens to get us into some sort of facility,"
Tanis said over the coded connection. The captain merely nodded and said something about a swan in the pond. The walk to the office tower was short, and Tanis easily located the door they were to use. She placed her hand over the panel and passed the codes to unlock it. They walked down a short flight of stairs and she unlocked another coded door. Tanis had expected some sort of hidden laboratory or research facility, teeming with scientists working on the next greatest breakthrough. Instead, they found themselves in a small room facing a nondescript man, sitting at a drab desk.
"Ah, you are on time. Good," the man said. "If you'd please sit and give me your arm."
Tanis looked to the captain, who shrugged, and back at the man. "Why would I do that?" she asked. The man frowned.
"So that I can give you the package. It has to be injected into you. It's not something you can carry around."
Tanis weighed her options and decided to sit and offer her arm. If this was an attempt to kill her, it was the oddest yet. She looked up the man whose breath had held the message in the park, as well as this man, and found connections to various Enfield holdings. As far as she could tell, this was a legitimate handoff.
"It's okay."
The captain placed a hand on Tanis's shoulder. "It's required for the nature of the package." Tanis looked into the captain's eyes. She saw only calm sincerity. He had never given her any reason to distrust him.
"Very well."
She sat. The man reached under the desk and placed a case on it. He opened it and withdrew a small needle.
"It won't hurt much."
Tanis wasn't worried about whatever pain the needle might cause. She was concerned about what it might deliver. The man slid the needle into her vein and pressed the plunger. Tanis and Angela immediately began to analyze the contents.
"It's some sort of nanocluster moving a container," Angela said.
"I see that too, but I don't see how to look inside.
It's making a beeline for your liver."
"Ernest said you'd try to open the package," the man said. "He asked that you refrain. It would be damaging to your health if you did so."
"Is that it?" the captain asked.
The man nodded and Tanis rose, again searching the captain's eyes for a clue. Andrew shook his head no and gestured for them to leave. Tanis rolled her sleeve back down, even more determined to find out what strange nanoscopic cargo she was carrying. Back on the street, she and the captain began to make their way to a maglev stop 3 blocks away. From there, they would catch a jump jet back to Mount Apollinaris and the elevator there. Tanis noticed a man with long dark hair cast an appraising eye at her as she walked past. She wasn't unfamiliar with receiving looks, but something about him struck her as strange. She moved her nano cloud out, looking for any suspicious behavior. On crowded, planet-side streets, that was nearly an impossible task. Stations and ships had rules about what could be done where and when. It kept things safe, predictable, and orderly. Planets were the embodiment of chaos. People lounged in entryways, ground cars sped past, and both humans and robots flitted through the air above. A block from the maglev station, something caught her eye. A man was leaning against a restaurant's door frame, appearing to be bored and disinterested with his surroundings, but his eyes flitted to her 3 times in 10 seconds. She watched him through her nano cloud and saw him glance at a woman across the street who also cast Tanis a furtive look. "We have company," Tanis said to the captain while passing him the faces and locations of her suspects. The captain didn't respond, but increased his pace. Tanis slid a hand into her pants pocket, threw a cut in the fabric, and drew her light wand out of her leg. "By the way, don't die," the captain said. "I don't really intend to." "Good, because the package you're carrying will self-destruct if you do."
"You are going to tell me what this is when we get back to the Intrepid."
Tanis was not pleased with being kept in the dark.
"I promise."
The man and the woman Tanis had identified before were moving toward them from the front, while another 2 women were approaching from behind. The street was too crowded with not enough cover. Tanis stepped into a shop that sold souvenirs, and the captain followed. They pushed past people arguing over buying rocks from the bottom of the Borealis Ocean or meteor fragments from the Hellas Sea. A man stood behind the counter wrapping trinkets and processing transactions. Tanis spotted a stockroom behind him and worked her way around the counter. The man was too startled to speak as she pushed past him, finally gaining his voice and calling out as they slipped through the stockroom.
"Hey! What are you doing?"
Tanis ignored him, and moments later they were pushing through a back door into a wide alley.
"Get to the train?"
Andrews asked. Tanis shook her head. "No, they'll be waiting for us. We'll double back and find a ground car." They broke into a run, moving away from the train station. Tanis had to resist breaking into a full sprint. There was no way the captain could match her augmented speed.
"Stop!"
a call rang out behind them. It was a male, likely the man she first saw in front of the restaurant. A shot rang out and Tanis felt a ballistic projectile whistle through the air near her right shoulder. "I guess they don't know that they shouldn't kill me," she said.
"Could have been a warning,"
Andrews replied as they rounded the corner moments before 2 more projectiles whistled past. Tanis cast a frantic eye up and down the street, looking for a way out of this mess. "There!" She pointed 2 blocks over where taxis waited in front of a hotel. The pair had to backtrack across the street they started on, and Tanis knew it was likely that one of their assailants was doubling back. With no other option, she and the captain took off at a run. Sure enough, as they approached the intersection, a woman stepped out in front of them. The woman raised her gun and time seemed to slow for Tanis. She shoved the captain aside as the woman let out a cry and fired her weapon. In a split second, Tanis calculated the angle of the barrel and trajectory of the bullet. It would hit her. She jerked her prosthetic arm up and braced for impact while throwing her light wand. The light wand entered the woman's face through her cheekbone, dropping her with a scream. Tanis raced toward the assailant, barely aware that 4 bullets had struck her. The woman was writhing in pain as Tanis approached and tore the light wand up and out through the top of her head, ending her pain. The captain was beside her in a moment, scooping up the woman's weapon.
"Are you hit?"
he asked.
Tanis grimaced and nodded as she picked up speed, pulling him across the street.
She took 3 in her prosthetic arm, only superficial damage. One is lodged between 2 ribs. I'm working on pushing it out, Angela supplied.
More shots rang out as they dashed across the intersection. One caught Tanis in the right shoulder, and another grazed the captain's leg.
Don't stop,
Tanis ordered, while catching the light wand as it fell from her numbed right hand. This was the last time she listened when someone told her to go anywhere unarmed. People scattered as they ran toward the sidewalk, shoving anyone too slow to move out of the way.
Get down!
Tanis called out to the people on the street, afraid that a bullet meant for her would end an innocent's life.
Don't forget about your life, Angela said. Believe me, it's very much at the forefront of my mind.
Most of the pedestrians dropped to the ground, but enough took off running that Tanis and Andrews managed to disappear into the milling crowd long enough for them to make it to the taxi stand. Angela had repaired enough of the nerve damage in Tanis's right shoulder that her hand functioned again. She swapped the light wand again and grabbed the door of the first cab with her prosthetic arm, ripping it open and tossing out the driver. The captain crashed into the seat beside her and Tanis hammered the accelerator while cranking the wheel. The ground car spun around and took off away from the attackers. Several stray shots hit the back of the car, causing Tanis and Andrews to duck instinctively.
That was bracing, the captain said.
Tanis looked over to see that he was pale and shaking slightly.
Are you hit anywhere other than the leg? She asked.
Andrews looked himself over.
I don't think so. My internal checks all pass. I do seem to be having a blood pressure issue from the sheer terror,
he said with a weak smile. I guess I'm more used to it than I should be, Tanis replied, as she cranked the wheel, sliding around a corner, missing oncoming traffic by less than a meter. The captain was gripping his chair and the dashboard.
I'm not augmented like you, you know. A bullet to the head, or a car for that matter, would kill me.
Noted, Tanis replied. I'm more worried about bullets. They're trying to hit us. The cars are trying not to.
The car's hollow overlay showed 2 other taxis in close pursuit. Their attackers must have also commandeered transportation.
Where is local law enforcement?
The captain asked, looking out his window into the air.
It's inaccessible, Tanis replied. I've been trying to reach them for some time, but their network keeps responding as busy. I'm guessing whoever is after us has some sort of a hack in place.
What are our options? The captain asked.
Tanis threw a cloud of nano into the air, sending it behind their car.
Don't worry, we'll have these clowns off our tails in no time.
Angela directed the nano to the engines of the cars behind them. The electronics yielded to the military-grade nano, and the car's engines stopped and the brakes engaged. The nano sent back a final image of their attackers before the internal safety mechanisms engaged, saving the passengers from certain death as the cars went from 100 kilometers per hour to 0 in a matter of seconds. Tanis saw the enraged face of the man she had passed on the street when they left the Enfield office tower. What was she carrying that he would go to these lengths to get it? She slowed from her breakneck speed and programmed the car to take them to a nearby parking garage, where they would switch vehicles before driving to the airport.
Your nano is really quite effective,
Andrews commented. Tanis nodded. Only the best for the TSF, but somehow I think that my nano is not worth a lick beside whatever is currently holed up in my liver. Andrews placed his hand on hers, sending a direct message. I imagine you've heard of Picotech.
Calamity. Stellar date 324-1790. August 15th, 4163. Adjusted Gregorian. Location GSS Intrepid, AI Primary Node. Region LHS 1565. 0.5 AU from Stellar Primary. 40 years later. The Intrepid lost control of its drive system. The ship's AI detected a fault in the neural nodes that managed the fusion engines. It switched to the backup systems, but those nodes crashed and went offline. Milliseconds later, power failures cascaded across the ship, taking out key systems. In less time than a human took to blink, The AI felt more than a 50% reduction in its ability to think. The AI named Bob by its human avatars ran through priorities. First on the list, take the fusion reactors and the antimatter annihilator offline while he still could. If they were cut off from his control, there would be no way to detect, let alone stop, a runaway reaction. He initiated a controlled shutdown only moments before losing all access to the stern of the ship. The few sensors responding via wireless interface showed that the command succeeded. Bob gave the AI equivalent of a sigh of relief. With the ship's reactors no longer producing power, the ship's systems began switching over to superconductor batteries. Several neural nodes powered back up for several seconds until an explosion amidships sent shockwaves through the decks as one of the SC battery banks took on heavy load and overheated. Bob ran through the power distribution. It was well below even nominal draw. There was no reason the bank should have failed, let alone exploded. More banks started failing, though less catastrophically than the first, until there were more batteries offline than functioning. As a result, large sections of the ship were powered down, and what neural nodes were left began switching over to internal backup energy. Another explosion rocked the ship, and reports streamed in from the bow. Visual inspection showed a large hole in the ES RAM scoop emitter. Bob looked over the logs and could find no indicators pointing to any failures anywhere. Everything should be working correctly. With the RAM scoop offline, the few small fusion generators running were now on stored fuel. Bob checked the reserves and found that while deuterium and helium-3 were at acceptable levels, lithium was critically low. Yesterday's logs showed 1 million tons of lithium. What was going on? Bob dedicated what processing power was left in the remaining bow neural nodes to poring through the ship's logs. He discovered subtle errors and inconsistencies. After a few minutes, the realization dawned on him that his sensors were reporting false data. A minute later, he confirmed even the positioning sensors had been reporting the starship's vector incorrectly. They were not passing by the star named LHS-1565. They were falling into it. The knowledge lent a sinister look to the star's dim red light. At a fraction of Sol's luminosity and a mass of only 115 mJ, it was on the smaller end of the stellar scale, not far beyond the threshold of being a brown dwarf, a fact that wouldn't stop it from vaporizing the Intrepid in its corona. He took a fraction of a second to consider the notion of seeing starlight as sinister. Such an action was not something he had been capable of before his first mental merge with his human avatars, Amanda and Priscilla. Having his mind melded with theirs provided new insights and perspectives, the most prominent of which was currently suspicion. It was also strange that in the 2 minutes since Bob had sounded the general alert, no humans had responded. Golly was on duty at present, and he was never more than a thought away. But now the AI couldn't find him. What few internal scanners still functioned showed no sign of the on-duty crew. Before the ship had left Sol 40 years ago, there had been a few random failures that were chalked up to sabotage. The STR Corporation had gone to great lengths to stop the Intrepid from getting to the New Eden colony, and many known sabotages did occur. Either some had gone undetected, or a second group had been involved. Either way, whoever was shutting down the Intrepid was on board now. But with the ship falling into a star, they wouldn't be for long. Bob checked the status on the servitors he had dispatched to survey the damage across the ship and found he had lost their signal. He was losing all signal across the ship. The wireless transmitters were going offline, and his distributed network was dangerously fragmented. Bob shut down all but his primary node to prevent a schism and gained a small insight into what the fear of death was like. Preservation protocols began writing data and algorithms to Crystal in an attempt to store his latest state. Those imperatives satisfied, he reviewed the remaining options. Humans were needed to solve the riddle. His remaining transmitters received a response from only the closest stasis chamber. He looked over the list of humans within the pods and realized all may not be lost. Tanis Richards was in that chamber. If anyone could get to the bottom of what was going on, it would be her. Correction. It had to be her. Bob initiated the protocols to retrieve the human and was about to provide her with a message on the general shipnet when all access beyond his node was cut off. He attempted to resend, but nothing worked. All physical connections were severed. Bob spent several long minutes trying backup systems and alternative data paths. His desperation increased, and for the first time in his life, Bob wished for a body. It would fall to Tanis. Alone in the dark. Stellar date 324-1790. August 15th, 4163. Adjusted Gregorian. Location GSS Intrepid, Officer Stasis Chamber B7. Region LHS 1565. 0.5 AU from Stellar Primary. Tanis stared at the hollow alerts around her. The words didn't make sense. She checked the general shipnet and found the same information. This couldn't be right. She had been awakened too soon. Or was it too late? Everything seemed to be offline or failing. "What the?" Angela started. "There's no wireless nets available other than the general shipnet, and I've only got local access to it." "I know. Auths are timing out on every other net," Tanis said, feeling as though she was blind, unable to see data on the nets, limited to just her own eyesight and hearing. "This can't be right." Angela examined the ship's vector. "We're falling into LHS 1565.
"I noticed that," Tanis said aloud, though her AI could hear her internal thoughts. Angela was a distinct entity, but also occupied a portion of Tanis's brain. Even if she didn't have access to auditory pickups, she could read many of her host's outermost thoughts.
"Are we alone on the ship? Where's Bob?" Angela asked.
Tanis didn't know. The ship's AI's presence had always been close, like a looming mountain on the shipnets. One of the most advanced sentient artificial intelligences ever created, she couldn't imagine what would shut down or block it.
"First things first," Tanis said. "We need more intel. There's no data on the duty officers, but that doesn't mean they aren't around somewhere. Let's get to the bridge."
"What about everyone here?" Angela asked.
Tanis looked at the rows of stasis pods, her gaze lingering on Joseph Evans's in particular. "They should be safe. Pods have their own backup power supplies. Besides, I'm going to recode the door and seal it." Angela signaled her approval, and within minutes they were moving through the ship to the bridge. The corridors were empty, and only the occasional dim emergency light provided illumination. Tanis added IR and UV overlays to her vision, as well as a structural overlay to ensure she stayed on the right path. Angela released a cloud of nano to scout ahead and keep an eye out behind them as well.
"There's nothing here," Angela said. "Life support is offline. Engines are offline. Energy interchanges are all dead. Everything is running on local power. When that dries up, it's going to get dark and cold in here really fast."
"How long ago do you think this happened?" Tanis asked.
"Judging by the rate of cooling and the current temperature, not long ago. Maybe an hour. We've probably got a few days before things will start to get serious," the AI responded.
Even though the cold didn't bother her, she was dependent upon Tanis for energy and connectivity. If Tanis died, she died. Tanis gave a stoic smile.
"Then we better get things fixed up.
Plus, if we don't smash into a star, we'll still freeze to death."
"I don't think that's quite how it would work. You usually burn up before any smoshing would occur," Angela said.
The empty corridors stretched on with no sign of life or recent use. She estimated the distance to the bridge to be just over a kilometer. Provided there were no sealed hatches on the way, she would be there in a matter of minutes. Tanis found herself wondering why she was awakened. No other stasis pod showed any signs of reviving their occupants, and there was no data left for her on the net. It had to be Bob who brought her out of stasis. But why not leave her with some information? They passed through the forward commissary, cutting behind the food stands and through Chef Earl's main kitchen, then into the executive dining room. It was a shortcut that would take them into a hall one level down from the bridge deck and only a few hundred meters aft. The dining room was dark. Chairs were stacked along the walls, and the tables showed a thin layer of dust. It drove home that 40 years had passed. By Tanis's reckoning, she had left this room only hours before. It was odd that it lacked more recent signs of use. It was one of the closest dining rooms to the bridge. Surely the duty officers would have been eating there, unless they felt uncomfortable and were using the officers' mess only one level further down. Tanis looked up who the duty officers should be and was surprised to learn she knew each of them personally. The first was GSS Lieutenant Collins, a man Tanis had not gotten along with particularly well before the Intrepid had left Mars. She had only spotted him once or twice afterward and was surprised that a supply officer had been added to the in-flight duty roster. The next was Lieutenant Amy Lee. She had been stationed under Tanis in the Security Operations Center in the harrowing days before the Intrepid left Seoul. Tanis knew Amy Lee reasonably well, but not as much more than an acquaintance beyond their working relationship. The last of the three duty officers was Ensign Gali. Tanis knew him from a few games of 4D chess they had played in the officers' mess, but had not worked with him professionally. She felt bad for Amy Lee and Gali being stuck with Collins. If she had to spend 3 years with that man, Tanis knew someone would be dead. Him.
"I hope Amy Lee and Usul are well. They were a very pleasant pairing," Angela said. Usul was Amy Lee's AI. He wasn't a military pairing like Angela, but had been with her family for several generations. When she made colony, he jumped at the opportunity to leave Seoul and transferred to her. Gali, like most pilots, didn't have AI. Most of their extra processing space was needed for additional systems to handle plots and vectors. Collins was simply too low on the totem pole to be granted any military AI, and he wasn't the sort who would normally attract an unchartered AI for a pairing.
"Gah, I've glimpsed his mind," Angela said. "You can get a feel for what a person would be like by looking at their data streams. Being in him would be like living in a prison."
Tanis reached the top of a service tube and stepped onto the bridge deck's maglev station. In all of her previous visits to the command deck, Tanis was one of hundreds crowding the station and executive corridor. Now the emptiness was palpable. Emergency lighting casting long shadows across the space as the echoes of her footfalls skittered up and down the hall. Beyond lay the bridge's foyer, the place where Priscilla and Amanda, the ship's two physical avatars, took turns providing the main interface between the humans and the Intrepid. The avatar's pedestal was empty, and the hollow emitters were offline. Even more than the main hall, this room had always been a riot of light and color, usually white, gray, and light blue if Amanda was ensconced, or red, pink, and violet if Priscilla was running the show. Tanis slipped through the darkness. A shiver ran down her spine, and she couldn't help but feel like she was the only person on the ship. There wasn't a single person who hadn't looked out into the cold, dark blackness of space and feared falling into it, lost and alone in the emptiness for eternity. Out here, far from even the most rudimentary civilizations, Tanis couldn't help feeling those thoughts creep into her mind again and again. She took a deep breath, pushed the tendrils of fear aside, and strode down the corridor to the left, past the executive conference room toward the bridge. Her nano arrived first and sent an image back, showing it to be empty, a fact she confirmed moments later as she stepped into the heart of the ship. She drew another deep breath through her nose. There were traces of human pheromones. Her augmented olfactory system informed her that people had been here a scant 5 or 6 hours earlier. Tanis felt the solitude pressing around her ease back as she settled into a duty station. The hollow interface sprang to life around her, and she brought up the previous month's logs. They were blank for the last month.
"Well, that complicates things," Tanis muttered.
"You got anything?"
"Negative.
Angela responded. There's nothing here and no helm control either. Engine systems seem to be physically disconnected, and on top of that, we are nearly out of fuel. The ram scoop is offline as well, and it appears the emitter is damaged. Are the habitation cylinders still spinning? Tanis asked. Not certain. I can't get any data on them. They do have their own self-contained power systems, so we can only hope they are. That's going to be one serious mess if those dropped to zero-G. Speaking of zero-G, Tanis said, we've still got grav here in the crew areas. I would expect so. The GE MBHs are fully self-contained. They generate their own power and are pretty hard to tamper with. So you're thinking sabotage as well, Tanis said. No way it could be anything else. To knock out that many systems at once before Bob could get servitors or the crew after you would have to require subversion. It's gotta be Collins, Tanis said. I can't imagine either Golly or Amy Lee being involved. It could be anyone. We don't know if they were the only ones out of stasis when this all happened. So we've got two things we need to do. We need to get to Bob and get him control of the engines, or we'll be having a really bad day. I project that we have either our initial pass or our first orbit to break away from the star. Any further, and we won't have enough V to escape its gravity. What's the time on that? Tanis asked. About 3 days. We'd better get moving then. Tanis left the bridge and worked her way back to Bob's primary node. Hopefully it was intact and he had run the preservation procedures. With luck, he would be fully activated and they could begin repairing whatever damage had severed him from the ship. On their way, she stopped at the officer's mess to see if it showed signs of use and to check for any clues. This room wasn't quite as Tanis remembered it. In the intervening 40 years, someone had decorated it. The previously white walls were done in several vibrant yet tasteful colors, and several new couches were also arranged throughout the room. The serving area in the rear was stocked with fresh food, and Tanis helped herself to a glass of water and a cold sandwich. She suspected it would be a while before she got to eat again. Peeking into the walk-in refrigerator, she stopped and deployed a series of nanoprobes. Around one of the racks, she saw a pair of feet. The probes took stock and fed the view to her HUD. It was Golly. Judging by the pallor of his skin, he had been dead for some time. More than 12 hours, Angela said. With the moisture in here, I don't think he'll be recoverable. Too much decay. Tanis disagreed. There was always a chance they could bring him back. It was not too far above freezing down where he lay. It was possible to bring people back even after a day if the conditions were right. She crouched down beside the ensign and saw what the probes missed. There was a large hole in the back of his head. No, they wouldn't be bringing Golly back. Looks like it was done post-mortem, Angela said. Someone didn't want whatever info he had to be extracted. So it would seem. I'll move him to the freezer and then we can continue. Tanis hauled the ensign's inert form to the freezer and set him down gently. He'd been a good chess player. She was sorry they hadn't had the opportunity to know one another better. Closing the freezer door, Tanis took a deep breath and determined to pay back whoever had done this in like kind.
We need to keep moving. There isn't a lot of time.
I know. Less than 10 minutes later, they were at the entrance to the ship's AI's primary node. The entrance was a narrow corridor that was normally alive with scanners and hollow readouts. Beyond that was a large cube-shaped space where the node resided. Tanis attempted to deploy probes, but found she lost contact with them the moment they entered the corridor. Dampening field, Angela reported. Probably what's keeping Bob from controlling his nano or servitors outside the node.
I'd wondered about that, Tanis said.
Well, here goes nothing. She stepped into the corridor and immediately regained communications with her nano. They had stayed on course and were surveying the AI node. Tanis emerged from the tunnel and into the space the node occupied. It was similar to the communications nodes she had visited on Callisto not long ago, albeit somewhat smaller. The room was perhaps 20 meters per side.
A catwalk ran around its center, partially obstructed here and there by power conduit and ES waveguides, which were used for data transmission. The room was definitely designed with function over form. The node appeared to be offline at first, but the nanocloud reported activity, but at power levels suggesting it was running on backup energy.
"You're here."
The words were audible, though she had never heard it aloud. It was the same timbre Bob's voice always had in her mind.
"You're alive," Tanis said. "Angela and I were quite worried."
"If you can call this alive, then I suppose I am,"
the AI replied. "I'm crippled and trapped within this node. I have no external net access, and a dampening field is blocking my control of nano beyond the node." "We noticed that," Tanis nodded. "I think we can find the emitters and remove the field, but we need to know what happened. Where is everyone? How did all of this happen?" There was a pause, just a second or two, but an eternity for an AI.
"I'm not entirely certain. Since the event, I've been running through my logs and have found that there have been some gaps for some time, almost as though parts of my sensory input had been altered to not pick up certain events or certain people's movements."
"So you were blinded," Tanis said.
"In some respects, yes. I don't know if the sabotage was set up during those times or if some of it had been in place since we left Seoul. What I do know is that the timing was perfect. At first, I thought it was a viral attack, but it quickly became apparent that it was physical. Only someone who knew my systems with fair intimacy could have done this. Ernest and Abby built in many redundancies, and they were all circumvented."
"Have the attackers tried to breach this node?" Angela asked.
"There was an attack made by servitors, but I managed to repel them with nano once they entered the node. I also have some limited feeds throughout the ship. Calm paths that, while damaged, still have some bandwidth. I believe whoever has done this is trying to flee the ship via one of the interstellar pinnaces. If they depart after our first orbit of the local star, they'll have enough velocity to reach Seoul in roughly 100 years. I believe that is their plan."
"We need more people," Tanis said. "I can't go to the shuttle bays. Which one is it?"
"Starboard, A3.
"And deal with whoever is there and leave you unguarded. They could mount a physical attack here."
"I'll be safe,"
the AI said. Laser cannons lowered from the ceiling, and several armed servitors appeared on the catwalk, most likely the ones that had tried to attack the node. Now under Bob's control.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.